Hey, hi everyone. Just let me know in the chat if you can see me and if I'm audible. Just write yes or no in the chat if you can see me. Thank you, Shivani. Thank you, Abhinav. Thank you, Anju. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, everyone. Just give me a minute so that I set up everything. Yeah, guys, we'll wait for a couple of minutes for other folks to join, and then we'll start in 2 minutes. Yeah. In the meanwhile, if you guys can tell me if you were able to access the resources that I've shared with you, the page where all the recordings were present, were you able to access it? Or if you guys have any question, you can maybe ask right now in these couple of minutes. Cool. So we'll wait for a couple of minutes for other folks to join, and then we can start. Yeah, Ashish, I think you can connect with me on WhatsApp. I think you have my number, and then we can talk about this. Yes, guys, just 1 minute more and we are going to start then. Cool. Is everyone ready to start? Just tell me yes or no in the chat if you are ready to go ahead. Just write go ahead in the chat if you want me to start today's session. Just write go ahead in the chat. Yes. Yeah. So now we are going to start. Just tell me if whenever you guys could see my screen. Yes, just tell me if you can see my screen. Yes or no? Yeah, it is visible. Okay. So yeah, everyone. So today we are, first of all, thanks a lot for being here in the second session. I could see today we have how many people? We have 75 people. So the count has gone down to almost half of what it was on the other day. So yeah, so we believe that we are going to have maybe, so that is why we have some filtering criteria. So now people who participate in this session and upcoming session and who are going to complete the whole assignment that we are going to give you are only going to become the part of a like a for a more immersive cohort where we are going to study everything in depth. So this is going to be about technology 101, where we are going to talk about like the on the surface level, like what are the kind of technologies that a product manager should know, and we are going to cover the surface right now. Then we are going to give you an assignment by the end of this week, and people who complete the assignment are going to be the part of group discussion and more immersive discussion that we are going to do in the alternate week. Yeah, so now we are going to go ahead, and in the past session we have talked about why do product manager need to know about technology, how it can be useful for them, how this understanding can be useful for them, and then we have talked about what is like how the internet works and what is the front end and what is the back end. So guys, let me know in the chat if you have attended the first session. Yeah, or let me know in the chat if you were, yeah, so people who are attending, yeah, so people for whom this is the first session, write one in the chat. People for whom this is the first session that you are attending, please write one in the chat. Okay, cool. So I could see a few people are there. Yes, so now we are going to start, and I can assure you that you do not have to like, nothing would be looking unconnected to you. So now we are going to start the session, and today we are going to touch upon three things. One is technology stack. So you might have heard of like this company is using this kind of technology stack and this company is using this kind of technology stack. So we are going to understand what technology stacks are. Then we are going to talk about databases. Then we are going to talk about APIs today. Okay, we are going to cover these topics from a surface level so that you understand enough to get your curiosity aroused. And I have already shared the pre-reads of it on the channel itself, on the WhatsApp group, and also on the email. And after this session, I'm also going to again share all the items with you. So also tell me guys, how many of you have gone ahead and read the pre-reads as well that I have shared? Yeah, that's good. So yeah, people who have shared the pre-reads, I expect you guys to go ahead and ask some questions, okay? Because you have some better understanding of the topics that we are going to cover. So I expect some kind of questions from you. So yeah, we are going to go ahead and talk about today's session. So in the last session, we have talked about what a client is, what a server is, and what are the responsibilities of a client, what are the responsibilities of a server. And I have told you how we can break the client and the server into front end and the back end. So a front end has following responsibility, or a client has following responsibility. So the responsibility of a first responsibility of the client is to make sure that it can create request. Second responsibility is it can send a request. Okay, this is happening through a browser, or this is happening through an app which you are using on your mobile. Yeah, and then we can go ahead and talk about then the second responsibility of the third responsibility of the front end is to make sure that it can receive the response. And the fourth responsibility is to make sure that it can present the response, as in whatever it has received from the server, it should be able to paint it in front of the user, either in the form of a website or in form of any UI element on the app itself. So these are the four responsibilities that the front end has. Now talking about the backend, backend also has four responsibilities. One responsibility is to take the request from the server. Second responsibility is to process that kind of request. Third responsibility is to create the response. Like first is to receive the request, as in whatever client is sending you, you should be able to receive it. Second is you should be able to process it, as in you should understand what is the client is asking for. Third, you should be able to create a response, as in whatever the client has requested for, you should be able to go ahead and create the response accordingly. As in, if client is asking for, maybe if you are talking about Facebook and you are talking about facebook.com's homepage, then client is asking for home feed. If you are talking about a profile on Facebook, then the client is asking for a profile, then backend should know that how to create this profile and paint it in front of the user. And then the backend should also be able to send the response. And when the response has been received by the front end, it should be able to go ahead and paint that response in front of the user. Yeah, we are going to take question maybe after 5 minutes. First, let me cover all of these things. Yeah, so these are two things. And now we are going to go. So now to do all of these things, we need to do certain kind of things, and we need to have certain kind of understanding and certain kind of tools, certain kind of software. So creating request, sending request, receiving request, processing request, sending response, and receiving response, like these first three things. and these 1, 2 and number 4. Okay, these are pretty much standardized. So if you are using any kind of platform, if you are using any kind of service, these are going to be standardized, which is also known as, like, there are different kind of protocols that are used across the internet, such as the HTTP protocol, such as the TCP protocol. Those are like very technical terms, so I'm not going to cover them. But as an understanding, like for your understanding as a PM, understand that point number 1, 2 and 3 in front end, and point number 1, 2 and 4 in back end are very much standardized. Okay, so you don't have to go ahead and reinvent the wheel again. Those are pretty understandable things, and all of your developers are knowing about it, and developers don't have to code so many things in order to do these things really well. These things are already taken care of most of the time. Standard software will make sure that these things are taken care of. Now we can go ahead and the most of the work that is required in any kind of, in creating any kind of product, whether it is like a backend heavy product or a frontend heavy product, you have to work on two things. At the backend, you have to work on processing the request and creating the response. Okay, creating response is something that is going to take so much code, that is going to take so much effort. This is the place where algorithms are run. This is the place where data structures are created. This is the place where we go ahead and run our business logic. And this is the place where your logic will decide whether it has to connect with database, what kind of information does it have to take from database, and what are the file that is need to create. So for example, if you're talking about LinkedIn, then if a request comes to LinkedIn server, then the create response part will make sure that it has gone ahead and collected all the information, done all kind of calculation, ran all kind of information, and created a response to send to the front end. And at front end, the most important part, or the most important part that the developer has to take care of, is presenting the response, as in how the UI is going to look like and how the user can interact with it, which is what are the buttons, what are the interactions, what are the color, what are the structure. So these are the things which are important, very important. So in front end and back end, there are four responsibilities. Most critical responsibilities that is customizable and that has to be taken care by your technical team is number four in front end, which is presenting response, as in how the response should look like, how can user interact with it. And from the back end, it is creating response, which is running your algorithm, running your business logic in order to make sure that the use case of the customer is being served. Yeah, so guys, let me know on a scale of 1 to 5 if you have understand the differences between front end and back end and what are the responsibilities that each of them have. Yeah, and guys, who are talking about the WhatsApp group, we have reached the limit for WhatsApp group, but now we can see that around 10-15 people have left the WhatsApp group. So we are going ahead and we are going to see people who are going to attend lectures regularly. We are going to go ahead and add them again to the WhatsApp group. Yes, cool. So this is front end, this is back end. Understand that few things are already taken care of because we know that internet has almost like 20-25 years old now, and all of these basic things such as creating requests, sending requests are automatically taken care by your browser, okay, or automatically taken care by server softwares, which are Apache, which are Nginx, and different kind of server software are there, and all of the heavy lifting has been done by them. Your developer just have to focus on creating the response, running the logic, like what the business logic is, and then you have to take care of presenting the response. So in presenting the response, the most call is coming, the business logic has to come from the UI team, as in they are going to tell how it should look like. Okay. And then in creating the response, the logic has to be driven by use case, as in what is the business use case over there. Then you have to give that use case or the UI to the designer, and that is to the designer or to the coder. They are going to make sure that they are able to code both the backend and the front end. So designer is going to give the UI to the front end developers, and the front end developer is going to make sure that they can code that UI into something that browser can understand. And similarly with the backend, you are going to give them some kind of business logic, which they are going to make sure that they are programming in a particular language, which your server can understand. Yeah, so now we are going to take like an example. So we are going to see how Instagram works. Okay, and we are going to take like the similar kind of learning, and we are going to apply it over here. So what happens in Instagram? So you have gone ahead, you have opened Chrome in your mobile or in your desktop browser. We'll take desktop browser in this example. So you have typed Instagram.com and you have already logged in. Okay, let us suppose that you have already logged in on Instagram and you are clicking and you are going on Instagram.com in your browser. So this request will be taken to the server. Can anyone tell me what would be the intermediate process, as in from your browser to the server, what is going to come in between? Yes. And what is the use case of DNS? What is the DNS going to do here? Yes, so DNS is going to find what Instagram, what is the IP that is related to Instagram.com, because we can understand what Instagram.com is, but in order to find that particular server, it has to need some kind of IP. So the DNS is going to make sure that Instagram has been resolved to a particular kind of IP address, and that IP address will make sure that we are able to identify the server where the request should go. Okay, so now we have gone ahead and talked about the server. Now we look at what happens at the server. So you have talked at Instagram.com, and now we are going to go ahead and see what is happening at the server. So at the server, first of all, what will happen is that the server will try to understand what is the data that has been sent from the client. Okay, the client is going to send its IP address. It is going to send some additional information as the who the user is logged in, whether he has logged in or not. And they are also going to identify what is the kind of resource that the client is requesting. Okay, here the server will understand that the client is requesting the home feed. Why? Because I'm just talking about Instagram.com. If you click on Instagram.com, you are just going to get the home feed. So the server has understood with this information that I'm looking for home feed. The second information that is with the server is that user is identified as Ankit Shukla. So it has identified, because of the data that has been sent to the server, it has identified that the logged in user is Ankit Shukla. And then the third, the server is also able to identify that the request is sent via browser from the desktop. Okay, so the server can identify what the device is and what is the kind of browser that you are using. Based on this information, it is going to do few things. Okay, now, first of all, it has understood that we have to present the home feed. Now they are going to go ahead and your business logic is going to run, and the business logic is going to go ahead and tell, and it is going to tell the database that it is going to find some data. And what is that data about? So whenever you go and click Instagram, like go on Instagram.com, you are going to find a home feed. And what happens on that home feed is that you are going to find all the accounts that you have followed. All of the posts from those kind of accounts are going to be visible in front of you. Okay. So first step is search all the data to find the accounts that this user follows. So find all the accounts that Ankit follows, first step, and then find the post that has been created by these accounts. Then we have to combine this data and then create a web page with posts. Okay, where it should be name, where it should be images, where it should be styles, colors, buttons, follow button, and message button, and everything would be there. Okay, so the server is going to follow all of these things, and then it will send a web page which the client can understand, which the browser can understand, and that is how it is going to look to you. Okay, so what has happened is that I have typed Instagram.com. It has gone via DNS to the server. Now the server has this kind of information, which is important for it to give me any kind of response. Then it has understood the request. It has followed this business use case or business logic or algorithm. After this, it has gone ahead, collected that data. And after collecting that data, it has gone ahead and created a web page. And that web page has been sent to the browser, which the browser can understand and it can show it to me. Yeah, guys, tell me if you have understood this. Tell me on a scale of 5 if you have understood how this basic system works. Yeah, so here what we have done is we have just created the web page at the server level itself. Okay, so when the HTML is created at the server level, it is known as server side rendering. Okay, understand the term server side rendering. What it means is that whenever the server is creating the HTML page, when the server is creating the output, and it is just sending the output to the browser, which browser can understand. Okay, that is known as server side rendering. Now what happens if we take this part, like initially it was happening at server, but now there are so many advanced technologies which are built with JavaScript, such as React, such as Angular, that you can go ahead, you can just take the data from the server and you can do all of the elements, you can build all the elements on the all of the HTML at the browser itself. Okay, so these are known as client-side rendering systems. Okay, one is server-side rendering, where HTML page has been created at the server, while other is client-side rendering, where the web page has been created at the client itself. So this web page, so whenever you are going to create an Instagram feed, you need to get some kind of data. So whenever you call to the server's responsibility will be to just make sure that it is sending enough data. Everything would be created at the client itself. Okay, and what is the difference between the two? Yeah. So at server end, what happens is that most of the heavy lifting has been done by the server, which is it is responsible to create the HTML, while at client end, most of the things are done at the client end. And most of the time, it is a much optimized process to create everything at a client end. It reduces the reliability on your server. Okay, it reduces the dependability on your server. That is first part. It also reduces the kind of load that your server has. So your server does not have to create. And also, whenever you are going ahead and so, for example, these days, every product is going to have three interfaces. One is they are going to have a website. Second, they are going to have an Android app. Third, they are going to have an iOS app. What happens if the server is going to render, then server has to render the web page for the server has to render the interface for all of the three things. That is going to be a lot of work for the server. So what happens is that in this server, in client-side rendering, what we do is we are going to render, we are just going to take the data from the server and we are going to create a different kind of experience at Android, different kind of experience at iOS, and a different kind of web page at the browser level itself. So it will help you separate the concerns of your whole system. So the server is only responsible to get the data. You can just get that data and paint it in any way that you want at the client end. Yeah. Now tell me if any one of you has not understood what server side rendering and what client side rendering is. So now we are going to move ahead So some examples of server-side rendering. So while I cannot like repeat it again because it's going to take a bit of time and most of the people have understood it, so I would appreciate if you guys could go, maybe in the recording you can go and you can go through it again, but I can give you an example. So let us talk about instagram.com. if this particular thing, like if your browser receives the HTML itself. Okay, if the browser doesn't have to do anything, it is just receiving the HTML document, which it can show to the user. Okay, then it is going to be a server-side render page. While if we can go ahead, if in case that the client is only getting the data from the server, while it has to do the heavy lifting of creating all of the things together, then it is known as a client-side rendering. What is the advantage of client-side rendering? It is that you can just have server for your data needs and you can create any kind of client with your own needs. As in, you can create an iOS app, Android app, or a website above your server, which is providing you the data. Okay, that is one thing. And second, it also reduces the kind of load that your server has. But it has one flaw, okay, which is like whenever you are going ahead, when it comes to search engine optimization, there are few problems that occur when you do client-side rendering. So in popular applications, in all the new applications like which are created with React or Angular or any kind of popular technology, you are going to find that people are more and more using client-side technologies versus server-side technologies. And if you want to use client-side technologies, but you want to go ahead and create the response on the server itself, like create the page on the server itself, which is useful in some kind of scenarios, then you have to use different kind of technologies where you can use a client-side technologies, but the result would be similar as to server-side technologies. I know that is going to confuse you guys, so that's why I'm not getting ahead into it. I'm going to include some kind of reading material which can help you out for curious guys. Yeah, so Harshit has a very, right. So Harshit has a very good analogy over there. So let us understand that you have gone to a restaurant and you have gone ahead and you have ordered a certain dish. So the chef is going to go ahead, mix all of the things, and he is going to give you the ready-made dish. Okay, that is an example of server-side rendering, which is everything has happened at the backend. Okay, you don't need to take care of, you just have to eat. While if you are going ahead and maybe going at a restaurant where you have to sell, so maybe you are ordering something which you have to compile again. For example, you have got a ready-to-eat meal, then you have to take it to home, you have to compile it, you have to prepare it. It is not in the finished format, so you have to go ahead, you have to compile it, you have to prepare it, you have to cook it, and then you have to eat it. So this is the example of client-side rendering. That's a good analogy, Harshit. So tell me, guys, if you have understood what server-side rendering and client-side rendering is from a scale of 1 to 5. Yeah, now. So now we have understood that we have to do so many things. Okay. We have to go ahead and, you know, so we have to go ahead. We need to have a server. We also need to have so many kind of tools so that we can go ahead and so I have written down that. Yeah. So we are going to go ahead and at Instagram, we can see in all of this example that there are different kind of things that the server and the client are responsible for. Okay. And you can understand that in order to carry out all of these things, we need to give some instructions to the server. We need to give some instructions to the client and we need to operate some kind of things. We need to some kind of tooling, some kind of software and all. Okay. So every company use some or the other kind of technology, some or the other kind of tools or softwares in order to map this up. Okay. So for example, let us consider here. So search data to find account that this person follows. Okay. So in order to search data, you need to have data. And in order to have data, you need to store data. Okay. So in order to store data, you need to have some kind of database. Okay. That is first thing. If you are storing images, as in case of Instagram, then you need to have a file system. Okay. If you are going ahead and giving these, if you have to talk with the database, you need to have some kind of programming language. If you need to go ahead and paint a certain kind of picture at the client or paint a certain kind of image to the client, a UI which you can paint or a UI which users can see, you need certain kind of languages so that the computer can understand and they can understand your instruction and they can follow your instruction. So in order to give instruction to the computer to do and to apply all of these things that I have mentioned on the screen, you need to have certain kind of software, certain kind of programming languages, certain kind of workflows and certain kind of tools. And these tools that a company use is known as its technology stack. Okay. So let us take an example. What are technology stacks? So in technology stack, there could be three kind of, we can separate it into three concerns. One is the front end stack, which takes care of about everything that is related to the things that you see, which is the client, which is the front end. So HTML is one thing that a client understands. So if you see any kind of web page that is going to be written in a language known as HTML, HTML gives structure to the web page. Okay. Very popular language, very popular scripting language. Second is CSS. Okay. Whatever colors that you see, I'm also going to give you like some kind of tools and all so that you can go ahead. I'm going to include some kind of tools in the resources so you can go ahead and practice some kind of HTML CSS. But understand, it is not at all important for you to understand or to have hands-on knowledge of HTML CSS and any of these technologies if you want to become a product manager. So that knowledge is good if you want to have it for yourself or for curiosity. But for product management, it is not at all essential. It can add a value to your resume and maybe to your skill set. But for becoming a product manager, these are not eligibility criteria. So talking about the front-end stack, we have HTML, we have CSS, we have JavaScript, we have React.js. So React.js and Angular. So browser only understand three things: HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. HTML to structure the page. Okay, it is a skeleton where everything is placed. CSS to design everything, to give the color, to give the structure, to give the fonts and all. While JavaScript is to maintain the interactivity, as in if you click on a button, what is going to happen? And certain, if you submit a form, what is going to happen? This is taken care of by JavaScript. Now, if you go ahead and study HTML, CSS, and JavaScript, you are going to understand that if you want to create scalable websites, then if you are natively coding into all of these technologies, that is going to be very inefficient. So that is why we have came up with some kind of frameworks which are going to take care of all the mundane works by itself. And it makes it very easy to create any kind of website, any kind of web app. Okay. These frameworks are React.js, they are Angular, and there are 100 kinds of other frameworks out there which will help you create better website at a better pace or better efficiency. Then we have TypeScript, then we have Objective-C and Swift. So Objective-C and Swift are the languages that have been used at iOS. If you want to create an app for an iOS, you have to use Objective-C or Swift. And similarly for Java, for Android, you have to use Java or Xamarin or maybe Kotlin. So this is the front-end stack. Second is the back-end stack, okay. And at back-end stack, we have PHP. So these are the languages that are going to run most of your logic and they are going to rest on the server itself. So one such language is PHP, very old language, very popular language. If you guys have known about WordPress, then WordPress is written in PHP. Then we have Java, then we have Python, then we have JavaScript. So JavaScript is the single language that can be used at server and also at the front end. Then we have Go, then we have Ruby, then we have Django and Rails. So Ruby, as we have a JavaScript framework known as React.js. Similarly, we have a Rails framework, which is built on Ruby language. Similarly, we have a Django framework, which is built on Python. So what does a framework do? Framework will just make sure that your most of your common UI component, most of the common things that you do are already taken care of so that you can focus on your logic, you can focus on your use case. And then in the last part, we have certain kind of tools which are included in most of the tech stack that you are going to study, which is the server. As in, I have told you that you have to go ahead and you have to make sure that the server can listen to requests, it should be able to send the response as well. So Apache and Nginx are two very famous software, server software, which you are going to use. Then we have Elasticsearch, Redis, and MySQL, and there are hundreds of other software which you can use. Elasticsearch is going to make sure that you can go ahead. Rails for Ruby, so Rails is for Ruby. And Elasticsearch is going to make sure that you can search very effectively across a very large set of database. So if you are talking about search in very high frequency or high scaled website, they are going to use Elasticsearch or similar kind of things in order to make sure that search is very fast. Then Redis is a cache. We are going to maybe discuss a brief about it. And then there is MySQL, which is going to make sure that you can store the data into databases and you can interact with that database and you can take that information out of the database and you can put some information into the database and you can alter that information. Yeah, guys, tell me on a scale of 1 to 5, if you have understood what tech stack are. Cool. Now the most critical part. Okay, so how to use this information as a PM? As in, you do not want to become an engineer, you want to become a product manager. So how this information is going to be helpful for you as a PM? Okay, so now, first of all, you are going to find this information. So most of the time, most of the bugs are going to occur, most of the changes you need to do. Okay, so this understanding can help you find out which is the right team. Okay, although this is an indicative list, it can happen that your server or your client or your technology stack is configured in a different way. So you might have to go to different teams, but this is an indicative result. Okay, if your presentation seems buggy, as in if you're looking at the front end, and if you think that some button is off, some color is off, or some kind of information is maybe missing out over there, which should be there, some icon is here and there, then you have to make sure that you are going to the front end team. They should be able to resolve it. And every team has been divided into front end, back end, DevOps and all. So you know where you want to go. Then if you think that the logic is buggy or the data is not correct, the app only has a responsibility to present the data, but the data has to come from the back end, right? So if you think that this is the kind of bugs that you are getting or the data is not correct, then you have to reach out to the back end. Then if you are using any kind of third party analytics tool, okay, so most of the analytics tools, they are going to be used in the front end itself. Okay, so if you talk about Google Analytics, they are going to be implemented on the website front end. If you are talking about Mixpanel, it is going to be implemented on your app's front end. So whenever you think there is some kind of like discrepancy in terms of data, in terms of analytics and all, you should go to the client team, which is the front end team. So just understand how your system works. And in order to understand, maybe when you are onboarding as a new PM or if you are already a PM, then go to maybe talk to your engineering manager or your developer, okay, and ask them some kind of question, as in what does your front end look like, what does the back end look like, then it is going to help you out in order to resolve issues quickly and in order to reach the right team effectively. And then in the second part is that the second useful way is in mobile apps, it took longer to float changes to the clients. Okay, so understand that there are two kinds of products that you can create. One is the mobile apps and second is the website. So in website, whenever you make the changes on the server, it is going to make sure that the changes are also reflected on the clients. It's almost instantaneous. As you make the changes there, it is going to reflect the changes over there. But what happens in mobile app is that you have to go ahead and release the app to the users itself. And when the users are going to update it, then only they are going to see those kind of changes. Okay. So if there are some testable components which you want to test and all, and which are not yet finalized, make sure that you can configure them from the server itself. Because once it has gone to the client, if it is controlled by the server, it is controlled by the client, then you will run into problem if you want to instantaneously improve these kind of components, or you have to fix any kind of bugs. So if there are testable components that you see that could be under your control, you should be able to change anytime, make sure that they are configurable from the server if we are talking about an app. then you should also test how the app will work in the offline mode. Now you know that there is a backend and there is a frontend, and backend contains the logic part and the data part, while the frontend contains the presentation part. So now understand that app can also be like your app can also be used in an offline mode. So you should make sure that you do the test as in how your app is going to work if the internet is not there and if it cannot connect to the backend. And then the third part, which is the most important, is that if you understand the critical components of your product roadmap, then you are going to make your requirements better. Okay. Can any one of you give me an example of this? You can maybe tell me in the chat section and I'm going to unmute you to answer this. How understanding of technology, how the understanding of things that I've told you can help you make your requirements better. Yes, so I'm going to go ahead and unmute Aditya. Yeah, Aditya, you can unmute yourself and you can tell me.
So how would you make your requirements better? I think that translates into how well you understand what is being used, so that whenever there is a product roadmap or whenever you sit down with your developers or designers to have certain features, you know to an extent what your limitations are or what your expectations can be, and you don't try to build something or you don't try to achieve goals or outcomes that are beyond your scope.
Right. Understood. So if you have gone ahead and thanks a lot, Aditya. So if you have gone ahead and so first of all, which Aditya has said, which is the right answer, and then Mansi has also told that we can separate the user stories into front end and back end, which can help you out. And also, if you are able to communicate the value of the product or your product roadmap to the developers in a way that is going to make sense for them, then it can be very helpful for them. So for example, if I have told the developer that you have to today create an e-commerce website. Okay, I have just told the developer that I've given them the user stories and he has gone ahead and created a e-commerce website. Okay. Then maybe 6 months down the line, I tell him that now you have to create a system where anyone can come and they can go ahead and they can create the websites of their own. Now this is going to be a bit of a problem for the developer because you have not told them the roadmap. So they would have designed the architecture in such a way that they would have used maybe some kind of inefficient tools or things that are good at certain kind of scale, but not at that kind of scale. Okay. So if you are going to communicate, if you are going to understand technologies, then it is going to help you to make your requirements better and communicate things really well in advance to the developer so that they can take the right decisions at the right time. Okay. And also in terms of using scalable versus non-scalable things. So what happens is that if you are going to go ahead and give non-complete requirements to your developers, one day down the line, you are going to caught up in the bad decision that they have taken, which is also known as tech debt. So some things that we do in order to rush through the time in our when the requirements are not clear, and also where developers have to make certain kind of decisions in very hashed mode or very quickly, then we arise onto a situation which is known as a tech debt. And then again, maybe after some period of time, when the situation has gone, then your developer team has to work again in order to clarify that tech debt, which will also increase the time that will require you to ship any kind of further improvements. Yes, let me know if you have understood the third point better. Yes. So there are three cases. One is you can definitely reach out to the right team. Second is mobile apps. Now you understand how mobile apps work, then you can go ahead and maybe make things configurable on the server, which needs to change very often. You need to understand how the app is going to work in the offline mode. That is going to be a use case scenario. And then you have to make sure that, and that will also enable you to make your requirements even better. But now understand that although in this course, we have covered the basics, but every product looks different. So if you are going to become a product manager, make sure that in your initial couple of weeks or initial 1 month of onboarding, make sure that you talk to the developers in order to understand the system so that you know what are the limitations of the system, how it has been developed, and what are the decisions that have been taken, and how your technical team thinks about these kind of decisions. That is going to help you maybe pair better with the developers. not talking about the database. Okay, so now we have talked about this case of Instagram, where Instagram has to go, in order to give me my home feed, Instagram has to go ahead and it has to give me the user. It has to find out who are the people that I follow. Then it has to find out what are the kind of posts that they have created. It has to compile them and it has to show it to me. But in order to do all of this, it has to store this kind of data. Okay, it has to store this data at some place so that we can use this data. And data is most of the time the backend or the core asset of any kind of product or technology that you create. Okay, so let us talk about what is that. So store information related to your data in a structured way. So databases are used to store information related to your product in a structured way. Okay, let us take two examples. If you talk about Instagram, then Instagram might be storing this kind of data. It might be storing users, and it might be having, for every user, it might be having a name, their Instagram handle, they are registered on, as in when they have registered, and their bio details. They would also have some kind of other information such as followers, as in who is the user that has been followed, who is the follower, who is following that particular kind of user. Then there would be another kind of data set such as post, where we can talk about image, captions, and hashtag. This data has to be stored because this is the use case of the app. Now we talk about second kind of scenario, which is Robinhood app or Zerodha app, which is like a broker discounting platform. So here we can go ahead and see that at Robinhood or Zerodha, you have to store the stock details, as in what is the symbol of that stock, what is the company name, what is the company information. Then you have to store what is the price, what is the time, what is the symbol, because the time keeps on changing. So you have to find the price at that particular period of time, and then you can relate it with the symbol. And then you have to find the portfolio of the user, as in what user, which user has which kind of shares already purchased. What does his portfolio looks like? So you have to talk about user, the symbol of the stock that he has purchased, how many units he has purchased, and what was the total price that he has purchased. So all of this kind of structured data you have to store somewhere, right? And in order to store that, you can use databases. So databases are like very critical component of any kind of system that you are going to create, any kind of product that you are going to create. Now there are two kinds of databases. One is the SQL database and other is a NoSQL database. So although as a product manager, you need not to have any kind of this knowledge, but these kind of questions are frequently asked in the interview. So I'm going to give a brief as in how it looks like. So if you talk about SQL, SQL is a nodal technology and it has been like very time tested and battle tested and very popular these days as well. So SQL is about a structured query language where what we do is the data is stored in rows and columns. So look at it as a spreadsheet. In a spreadsheet, we have different kind of sheets and all of the information is going to be stored in these kind of sheets, which are known as tables. This, all the three C's are known as a database collectively. These different kind of sheets, they are known as like one particular kind of sheet is known to be known as a table. And then in each table, you can store related information that has to be stored in the form of columns and in the form of rows. Columns tell you what are the attributes of a particular kind of record, and rows are used to enter those kind of records. So for example, if you are entering the user, then we would have a users table at Instagram, which will contain the first name of the user, last name of the user, handle of the user, when he has registered, his, what was her email ID. And then we talk about the likes table, like people who talk about like, then this could also be a table where we can store all the related information according to the use case. So data is stored in the form of rows and columns. If you can compare it with a spreadsheet, that is a great example of how you can understand what SQL is. So every product has to create a schema before they can go ahead and implement this SQL. They can implement SQL or any kind of data set. So in SQL, it is very important to have a schema before, and as in you should know what is the information that you will need. So you should know beforehand as in what is the information that you are going to need and how you are going to store that information, what are going to be the column names, what is going to be the structure of your table, how many tables should be there. This is known as a schema. Okay. And before, in SQL scenario, if you are using SQL, you have to know it beforehand. Also, SQL is not automatically scalable. There are two kinds of scales. One is horizontal scaling. Other is vertical scaling. I'm going to give you an example. So tell me, guys, in the chat, if you have heard about this term, horizontal scaling and vertical scaling. Yes or no? If you have heard about these terms, okay, cool. So I'm going to tell you what it looks like. So there are two terms. Okay, so now, right now, if we create Facebook, Okay, then understand that Facebook is going to have maybe, I think last reported MAU of Facebook was around 800 million. Okay, so these many people come to Facebook every month. Okay, and at every second, maybe let's assume that 10 million people are active on Facebook. Okay, and if so many people are active on Facebook, then the server has to be really good. Okay, and in if you have to scale the server to this kind of scale, then you need to have the ability to scale the server. And then scale the server, and then you have to be able to serve all of these kind of requests. And in order to serve these kind of requests, you need to be able to scale your resources, any the server that you are using and all. So there are two kinds of scaling. One is horizontal scaling. So scaling is nothing, just you improve your resources, you upscale your resources in order to make sure that it can handle the load. Horizontal scaling and vertical scaling. Okay, so the server that we have talked about, they are nothing but they are computers. What kind of computers? Consider them as CPUs. Okay, and what does a CPU of a computer has, like, which is also known as server? It has RAM, it has storage, it has a processor. Okay, so these are the things that it might be having. Okay, so if I want to handle these kind of requests, maybe 4 GB of RAM, which is adequate, is not at all adequate for me. I will need maybe 1,000 times more RAM. Okay, so now in order to increase this RAM, so what I have to do is I can either increase the number of RAM into this particular PC, or I can go ahead and increase the number of PCs. Okay, so first of all, let us talk about horizontal scaling. In horizontal scaling, if you want to wrap up your servers, then you have to go ahead and increase the ability of your one device. As in, right now you are having 4 GB of RAM on one device. Now you will go ahead and add some more RAM. Maybe you will add 396 more and it will become 400 GB. But the device is the same. You have just increased the RAM content on that particular device. Okay. This is known as vertical scaling. So sorry, guys. Just give me a moment. Horizontal scaling, right? So what happens in horizontal scaling is that whenever a request comes, and if your server is not able to handle that request, what we are going to do, we are going to take help of multiple servers. Okay. So one server cannot handle it. Now we have understood that we would not need 4 GB, but we would need 400 GB. So we are going to go ahead and make sure that we are adding all of these servers. So we are going to add multiple devices. So these are different computers, also known as server. Okay, their collection is also known as a server, farm, or a cloud. Okay, so which means you are adding computers, which is known as horizontal scaling. You are adding computers in order to scale your system. This is horizontal scaling. Then comes vertical scaling, which I've already explained to you, which is you are just adding resources into one system. Initially it was 4 GB. Now you have increased the memory to 400 GB. This is vertical scaling. So vertical scaling is just increasing the throughput of the same device, while horizontal scaling is increasing the number of devices, right? So guys, tell me if you have understood what is horizontal scaling and what is vertical scaling and how it is useful. Yes, now. So coming back to our topic, which is, yeah, so now if you guys have understood what horizontal and vertical scaling is, so can you guys tell me what is better and what is not better, what is efficient, what is not efficient? Yes. So what happens is that if you are creating a small system, then vertical scaling is the way to go. Okay, you don't have to think about how to scale and all. If you have a small system, then vertical scaling is the way to go. You can maybe go ahead and increase the RAM and all. But there is a physical limit to how much RAM, how much resources, how much processing power that you can add to a particular computer. Okay, that is why in all the scalable scenarios, you have to go with horizontal scaling. Not because it is good or bad, but because it is the only availability. You cannot increase the RAM on a server two petabytes or something, right? It is going to be very efficient and it is going to create one point of failure, right? If this machine fails, it is going to fail everything. That is why we have horizontal scaling. Even if one machine fails, even if one machine is not able to do its task, everything is going to be taken care of. Yes. So for smaller systems, it is important. It is for smaller systems, it is good to go with vertical scaling. You don't need to over optimize initially. But when your system grows, you can go ahead and go to horizontal scaling as well. Now talking about our main topic, which is SQL versus NoSQL. So SQL by default is not suitable for horizontally scalable system, but there are different hacks, different kind of scenarios such as sharding and all, which you are going to understand system design, which can enable SQL to horizontally scale as well. So natively SQL does not support it, but we can use certain kind of hacks, certain kind of systems or certain kind of technologies to make sure that SQL is also vertically scalable. So natively it is not scalable, but you can go ahead and put some kind of system in order to make it horizontally scalable too. While if we compare it to the second part, which is our NoSQL database, they are by default horizontally scalable. Okay, so both are vertically scalable, but the additionally NoSQL is also horizontally scalable, but for SQL you have to do certain kind of hacks and certain kind of strategies you have to implement in order to make it horizontally scalable as well. And now talking about easier to join tables and do complex queries. So whatever system that you see, whatever system we have created in these years, most of the system have been created on SQL itself. Okay, so SQL has been able to do all of the kind of complex queries that you can think of. And we are going to cover like how to do SQL and how to do these kind of queries in a bit, like as in we are going to maybe discuss it tomorrow once you have gone through the session, the pre-reads that I have given you. So SQL in itself is very powerful. Now let us talk about NoSQL. So in NoSQL, the difference is that there the data is being stored in a spreadsheet format, as in the form of tables and rows format, rows and column format in the form of tables and databases. Here the database, the document or the data is going to be stored in documents or JSON files. Okay, the JSON file is going to look at this. JSON is known as JavaScript Object Notation. You can search on it on internet. Maybe you can read for it in a couple of minutes and you will know what JSON is. And then a JSON looks like this. Okay, a JSON is nothing but a key value pair. This is the key user. This is the name of the user. This is the key ID. This is the ID of the user. This is the key handle. This is the value of the handle of the user. Okay, so it is just a key value pair which is used to store any kind of information. While in SQL, we are storing everything into rows and columns. Here we need not to do it. It can just store them as JSON files. Then there is no need to specify schema before. As you can see that you can store anything there. Okay, there is no row or there is no column format. So you do not need to define the schema beforehand. But in SQL, you have to define it. This automatically scales. Since these are documents, you can document all of these. You can store these documents into chunks. These are different files. Okay, you can store them anywhere you want or in any kind of devices that you want. So half of the devices, half of the documents you can serve in one horizontally scaled server, while the other you can serve in all of the other scale servers. While at SQL, what happens is that they have to be on one system in order to operate. Okay, so in SQL, it cannot vertically scale because the keys and the way the system works is going to create discrepancy between your data. And then it is difficult to join data sets. Here, it is very easy to define the relation between the users, but here it is not. And that is why it is difficult to join data sets. And most of the time you will see that right now, like if we talk about 2012, 2013, when NoSQL was becoming very popular, there were these pros and cons which were standing and which were holding their grounds. But now in 2021, there is absolutely no issues with using any of these technologies because they have evolved and both of them can go ahead and they can serve all of the kind of needs that you can see. You can create both kinds of situations. Like you can create a Twitter with NoSQL as well as with SQL as well. You can create a Facebook with SQL as well and NoSQL as well. So there is almost no difference in terms of their possibilities. It is just the kind of priority that the developers give based on the knowledge that they have. So if your developers are aware about SQL, maybe they should go with SQL. If they're more familiar with NoSQL, they can go with NoSQL as well. I'm talking about the modern SQL and NoSQL. In modern SQL and NoSQL, whatever were the limitations have been already surpassed. Yeah, Guru has a question that can you use both for same application? You don't need to. You just need to store your data at one place. So why don't go ahead with this? But sometimes what happens is that it is found that it is, if you are creating very scalable system where you do not know the schema, then that part of your application you can create with NoSQL, while the other part can be on SQL, and they can talk with each other through something known as an API, right? So yeah, guys, before we can move ahead, maybe I can take some of the questions. Let me know if you guys have any questions in the chat. Forget about the question that you have asked till now. Just start asking questions in the chat. Yeah, I cannot go back in the chat so deep. So if you guys have any question, please go ahead and ask. Forget about the question you have asked in the chat. I could not go back to it. What is a schema? Yes. So Rita, schema is a format in which your data is going to get saved. As in, you need to store your data. You know your business logic. And in order to serve that business logic, you know, in order to serve that business use case, or in order to serve experience to the user, you need some kind of data. How you are structuring that data is known as the schema. So schema is nothing but how do you structure your data so that it can be stored in your database. Yes, Rohit Kumar, right now, it is agnostic. You can use any of the tools and they have like their own pros and cons. And most of the time we are using them because the developer is going to make the call because he was familiar with that. And that is the right call to make. But if I tell you about the usual choices that people make, if you are making like a traditional application, I believe SQL is a way to go for it because the use cases are already defined. You know what you need to do. But if you are creating very heavy tool, such as analytics tool where you have to do a lot of reads and lot of writes, their SQL, their Java, their NoSQL is the way to go. So if there is a traditional web application that you need to create, which is only supporting create, read, update, and deletes, and reads and writes are not going to happen at a very larger scale, then you can use NoSQL. But in other cases, you can go ahead and use SQL as well. But having said that, right now at this point of time, the choice could be agnostic. You don't have to think about, just go with what your developer knows and what they are familiar about. Yes, Adarsh has a question that what is shown to us is real-time data. Price of stock, location, price. Yes. That's a good question. So apart from databases, as in SQL and NoSQL, we have something. So these are the databases. And generally, if you are going ahead and querying your database very often, then it is going to be a roadblock or a bottleneck to your system's latency. Okay. As in database is something that takes the most time in order to retrieve the data. So what you have to do is there we have something known as a cache. So what you are going to do is you are going to use some advanced things such as Redis, such as Kafka, such as Memcache, which will help you do all of these kind of things. So for example, if you are going ahead and reading all of your tweets, okay, it is not possible for Twitter to go ahead and present all of these things so fast to you if they are using a database or they are using SQL and all. So they have to use something known as Redis, known as Memcache, known as Kafka in order to make sure that a real transaction could be visible to the users. We are going to talk about these things in the system design part. Yeah, since one customized user experience using client side rendering, wouldn't everyone use it then? Are there any company who just stick to SSR? Yes, Vibhu, so most of the companies have been already moving to client side rendering, but yes, there are some legacy systems which are SSR, and there are some pros of SSR, as in if you are looking about, like if you want to So first of all, these technical decisions. So as I have told you that whatever particular technologies can does, for example, whatever Java can do, Ruby can also do. Whatever Ruby can do, maybe Python can also do. Okay. So these are almost equal in terms of most of the use cases. I would say 99% of the use cases. But what happens is that it is a preference of the developer that they have taken. Might be the companies which are using SSR right now, they might be already into that kind of mode where the developers are already like are only aware of this kind of thing and that they don't want to take a plunge into CSR. Yeah, but most of the time we are seeing today that CSR is a way to go. And just one problem with CSR, that whenever you are relying on search engine traffic, then it might happen that Google is not able to understand your client-side rendered pages. It would be able to understand server-side rendered pages, but there would be some kind of problem that can occur when you are using client-side rendering. Yeah, can you relate NoSQL with horizontal vertical scaling? What falls under which type and just to understand correlation better? Yes, so SQL is into vertical scaling most of the time, but there are methods available today, such as sharding, which can help you, or such as master and slave replica, that can help you scale the SQL also horizontally. While NoSQL, if we talk about NoSQL, it can be used for both vertical scaling as well as horizontal scaling. Yeah. I hope, Rohit, you got your answer. I hope, Bibhu, also you got your answer. Right. If you guys have any question, write it down or just let me, or if you want to move ahead, just like go ahead in the chat. Yes. So now we are going to do an exercise and we are going to see that how we can build a simplified schema for LinkedIn. Okay, now we are going to build a schema, as in what does the database might look like if we are going to create a very simplified version of LinkedIn. Okay, and this is going to be a foundation of our SQL understanding. Okay, and so let us understand this. So the coming session is going to be as follows, that we are going to do this, and then you have to study, like I'll be including a pre-read into the notes, and then you have to read this pre-read today, and tomorrow we are going to cover how to do these SQL queries and all with certain kind of tools. Okay, so now let's assume and let's build a simplified schema for LinkedIn, and we are going to support four features. Okay, one is the users are going to get created. Second is the users can create post. Third is user can react to the post, and fourth is user can create connections. Okay, these are the four things that we need to take care of. So how we should go ahead and create a simplified schema for LinkedIn. Okay, as I've told you that we are going to use MySQL, we are going to use SQL over here. Okay, and let us start with a blank spreadsheet. Okay, so to make this simple, I have used the spreadsheet. The analogy is very good here, but if you guys are more advanced, and I'm going to give you an assignment, and in that assignment you have to use this tool known as SQL diagram. Yeah, draw SQL diagram. I'm going to include this link. So right now I am using this spreadsheet in order to explain it to you, but when you are going to complete it as an assignment, you have to use this tool. I'm going to include that link as well. Okay, so now let us understand what are the different kind of tables that should be there in LinkedIn. Okay, in LinkedIn's database. So first I can see that there are going to be users on LinkedIn. Definitely I need to store their information. Then the users are going to go ahead. So what is the information that I have to store in the user? First of all, I have to include the name of the user. Can you guys suggest something what I should include? We are creating LinkedIn, right? We are creating a database for LinkedIn. Then what are the things that we need to include? Yes. Yeah. So we are going to include email. We are going to include phone number. We are also going to include the bio, as in maybe a profile bio. Okay. Or a short introduction about yourself. Right. So these four things we are going to include. Right. Then we have to go ahead and create that. We have gone ahead and created a post. Okay. People go ahead and they post statuses, update on LinkedIn. Let us see how we are going to take care. So if we want to store post, what is the content that we should store? What should it look like? One is the content of the post. Or maybe let us say, what is the caption of the post? Yes. Let us talk about caption. Let us talk about hashtags. let us also talk about when this was created, right? Right. So we are only assuming that we are only supporting the text-based post right now, not image-based post. I'm going to give it to you in the assignment that I'm going to give you. Okay. So the caption we are going to store as in what do we write, what are the hashtags, and when the post was created, right? So now can anyone if you tell me how I am, so for example, I have gone ahead and I have created, so let us create a user, right? So I am going to create maybe, Shankar as a user. So Shankar is a user, his name is Shankar and his email is shankar@gmail.com. His phone number is 12345678 90 and his profile is something. Okay. So Shankar has gone ahead and Shankar has created a post. Okay. And Shankar has written that I have enrolled in Hello PMs Tech 101, right? Shankar has included two hashtags there. Let me just increase the font size. Yes, Shankar has included two hashtags. One hashtag was PM and other hashtag was product management. Okay. And Shankar has created it maybe tomorrow. Okay. Maybe let us write the time. So 12 November, maybe he has created on 12th November at 12:03 AM. Okay. So now this is the information that we have. Now, how am I going to make sure that, how I'm going to find that whether this post has been created by Shankar or someone else? Can any one of you tell me? Yes. Correct. So now we are going to do something. So yeah. So Harshit has told me that we can use email ID. So maybe let us go ahead and create email ID here, right? And then I have included his email ID, which is shankar@gmail.com. Can any one of you tell me what is the issue with this? So if you want to relate two tables, you need to have some common information among them. Okay. So in users, I'm going to identify Shankar with some unique key. Okay, which is also known as the primary key. And every attribute, every row that is going to come in that particular table has to have unique value of that key. Okay, so if Shankar is there, this key has to be something. If someone else is there, that key has to be something else. So a primary key is something that can help you identify a unique record in any kind of table. Okay, so that is the primary key. Now there is something known as the foreign key, which is going to relate two tables. So here we have two tables, one is user and the post. And if I need to find which user has created which post, I need to have some common connection between both of these tables. Okay, here Harshit has suggested that it should be email. So can any one of you tell me, is this the right solution or we have to do something else? And why this is going to be problematic in the long term? No, first tell me what is the issue with email ID? Why we cannot have email ID here? Yes, Suhas has the answer that email can change. Okay, so for example, right now I'm using certain kind of email. Maybe I'm enrolled in a school and I'm using my school's email ID. Maybe when I graduate from the school, I'm going to use a personal email ID. And that period of time is LinkedIn has taken my that particular ID. And if I want to change the ID, they have to change the ID all across. Okay. So whatever post I have created, so there are going to be hundreds of posts that I'm going to create. And this ID is going to be reflected everywhere. So if I have to go ahead and change my ID, then this has to be reflected everywhere. Okay. So whenever we create an ID, whenever we want to create any kind of primary key, we are going to make sure that it is auto-generated. It is created from the system itself. So let us see how it works. So every table schema that you create, every table schema needs to have some or the other kind of unique ID, which is known as the ID of that table, primary key of that table. So we are going to label it as ID. Okay. For this table, it is going to be known as ID, but for other tables, it is going to be known as user ID because it is representing ID in the user's table, right? So let us see Shankar's ID is 1. Okay. And then we can go ahead and here we can replace it as user ID. And what was the user ID of Shankar? It was 1. Okay, so now Shankar can create as many posts as he wants, and the system would be able to identify how many posts Shankar has created, right? It can just count, give me the count of all the posts all the rows that are there in this table where user ID is equal to 1 that are going to give me all of the things that Shankar might have posted. Tell me, guys, if you have understood this concept of primary key and the foreign key. So primary key is something which is able to, which through which you are able to uniquely identify what is there into this particular table, what is there into this particular record. Okay. So every user that you are going to add is going to have certain kind of unique ID. Okay. No two IDs can match. Then there is a foreign key, as in which is going to relate one table to the other. Here, user ID is that particular foreign key. Yeah. Tell me on a scale of 1 to 5, guys, if you have understood how this works. Yes, now. So we are missing something in this table. Can you guys tell me what we are missing in this table? In post table, we are missing something. What is that? Yes, we are missing a primary key, because right now, if I have to create reactions, as in people can go and they can react on these posts, right? So I have to create reactions. And for reactions, I need to have what? Type of reaction. There are 5-6 type of reaction that you can do. What is the user ID? Which user has given that reaction? Okay. On which post have I given that reaction? Now, if I do not have any post, if I do not have a ID here, how am I going to find which post was this reaction for? Okay. Yeah. So let us insert this. So I'm going to include an ID over here. In this table, it is going to be known as ID. It is the primary key. But in other table, it is going to be known as a post ID, because it is referencing something from the post table. Okay. So here we have the post ID, right? So whenever you create any table, make sure that first of all, you are including an ID, which is auto increment and which is unique in SQL databases. So going ahead, so if someone has gone ahead and liked something, okay, then it's one is the ID. This is the first reaction. What is the type of reaction? Maybe it's smile. Okay. Or maybe it's like. What is the user ID? Maybe let's say that there is number two user who has done. Who is the number two user? Let us create one user. Two users, and her name is Tanya, and her email is something, and her phone number is something, and her profile description is something. Okay. Now I can identify this user in the table as in the whole system as ID number two. Then for reaction, I can go ahead and say that Tanya has gone and reacted a like or given a like to Shankar's post. So whenever she presses on this like button, this data is going to be sent to the server, and the server is going to give it to the logic or to the program. And that program, that programming language that you would have implemented or you have written your code into, is going to tell the database that why don't you insert this record? What is that record? That this person whose name was Tanya, which is represented by the user ID 2, has reacted, has liked, like this particular post. Which particular post? Whose ID was 1? Correct? So this is how we are going to create it. So you can understand that users can have multiple posts, which is known as one to many mapping, right? Then a post can have many reactions, which is one to many mapping. While most of the posts can be done by most of the users, right? So there is many to many mapping. Any question till now, guys? Yeah, Tanya has a question that why we can't use email as primary key. It is also unique. Yes, Tanya. Email is also a unique key, but there are two reasons why we do not use email. First is people can change their emails. Okay. And if you have changed your email, and if your email has been mentioned across the table, then it is going to take a bit of effort in order to update it from every place. That is the first reason. Second reason is integers by default, they are much more, and the unique IDs by default, they are much more efficient into databases rather than the complex information or non-uniform information such as an email ID. Yeah, guys, tell me on a scale of 1 to 5 if you have understood how to create a schema. Yes. So now you have to go to, like, you have to go as a pass of assignment. You have to go to this tool, which is known as DrawSQL, drawsql.app. Just go to get started. Log in with the account that you have been using. I'm not sure if I have a login here. I'm not sure if this is going to work. Yes, so this is working. Yes. So let us create a new diagram. And right now we have taken the help of this. Yeah, right now we have taken the help of this spreadsheet. But now this is how you can go ahead and create and draw SQL.app. So you just have to create a new table. Name of the table is users, right? What is this? First is ID, they have already added, right? Because ID is important. Then you can add the name. What is the type? So types are the character type that they can store. I'm going to give you a resource where you can find all of this. So just find out what is the data type that is going to store. Maybe it's a string, as in a set of characters, or varchar. Yes, it is a set of characters, variable characters. DrawSQL is not a type of NoSQL. No, it is not a type of NoSQL. So it is just a tool that you can use. That's it. It is a tool. Yes. So you can go ahead. You can create whatever you want here. Add one. This is deleted. Add column name. I might write email. Again, this is going to be a varchar. Add column. Then I'm going to add maybe. Yeah, I think that should be enough for now. Then I can go ahead and create a new table, which is the posts table. Okay, and then post, what we have the ID, we have the caption, we also have the hashtags, and we also have when it was created, right? Created at. So in caption, we are going to use text, because we do not know how long it is going to be. In hashtag, we are also going to use text, and in created at, we are going to use maybe date time. Okay, this is it. So now two have been created. One is the post and other is the user. So maybe we can create the. Yes, so let me see. Yeah, we can take it there. Yeah, so we have post, we have user. Now we have to explain what is the relationship between them. So just every ID. So in post, we have not created the user ID yet. We have not created the foreign column. So let me add a column, which is user ID, right? So this is the user ID, and then I can connect this user ID to, I can connect this user ID to this, right? This is going to show me, and this is also a one to many representation. Okay, which means a user can have multiple posts. This is one to many representation. So this is how you are going to, when I'm going to give you assignment tomorrow, you are going to use the same tool in order to create that. Yeah, guys, I think we are running out of time. So I think we can cover the APIs for tomorrow. That is an important topic. I don't want to rush through it. Tomorrow we are going to understand APIs and webhooks, and we are going to also understand. Yeah, so Balaji, these are only the tools that you are going to use. That's it. It doesn't matter. Like the SQL is going to remain the same. There are different kind of functionalities that one tool provides versus the other tool provides. That's it. And there is a certain change in the technology that you use. Not something that a product manager should be aware of, just that your developer would take care of this. Just you should know how to write SQL and how the data schema works, because schema is going to be very important for you. You need to know what the schema is, because when you do analytics, when you take data or when you give data to the anyone, when you analyze data, you need to know what your schema is, right? That is how you are going to get the data. And if there is some kind of critical information which you want to be in your reports so that improve the user experience, then you have to make sure that you are including it into the schema itself. So yeah, guys, I think we should. Yeah. So, but before we are wrapping up today's session, but before you could leave, please go ahead and submit the form that I have given in the chat section right now. Okay. Your feedback is very important. Make sure that everyone who is in the call right now is going to give the feedback. I can see there are 72 people. Please go ahead and give the feedback. There are 71 people I can see. Please go ahead and give your feedback. Don't leave without feedback. That's the only thing that we are asking you for the time that we are investing in you. So please go ahead, give the feedback, and we are going to see each other tomorrow at the same time when we are going to study APIs, okay, and in APIs we are going to understand so many examples in how APIs works and all. And we are also going to discuss the coming assignments in tomorrow session. So it's very important to attend tomorrow sessions. And people who are going to miss out on session, make sure, although I am going to make sure that recordings are available, but you are not going to get entry in the coming cohort, which is also free and which is an advanced version of this. So please make sure that you are attending the sessions. Yeah. Thank you, everyone. I am going to see each other tomorrow. Make sure that we are going to see each other tomorrow. Make sure that we are going ahead and you are going ahead and submitting the feedback. And if you guys are running into any kind of question, feel free to mail us at info@hellopm.co. We'll make sure that we are addressing this. Yes, Ashish, we are going to first discuss it tomorrow and then we are going to send it to the email. So every communication, it happens on WhatsApp plus email. So you are not going to miss out on any of the communication. Just make sure that you are adding info@hellopm to your contact list so that you don't miss out on email if it is landing into updates or promotion or spam. Yes. Also, if anyone has any question, I think we have 9 minutes. So if anyone has any question, please go ahead. Yeah, Balaji, you might be not getting WhatsApp messages because many people are not included in that group because of the size of that group. Right now, I'm going to see the attendance of that session. We have some things set up and then we are going to go ahead and make sure that we are removing all of these people who are not attending. And then we are including people like you who have been attending. Cool. So if you're not attending, just send me an email. If you're not able to access the WhatsApp group, just go ahead and send me an email at info@hellopm.co. I'm going to make sure that I'm including you over there. Yeah, thank you, Abhishek. Thank you, Sai. Thank you, everyone. Yes, Shubham. So I have, yes. So I have been a coder myself. So initially I started my journey. So I have studied Java in 8th, 9th, 11th, 12th in my college years and in my school years. And then my college was IIIT Gwalior. So we have a good coding culture over there. So I was there. I coded there for around 4 or 5 years. Like I had created my own systems and also the Hellopm website and the email system that we have created, the LMS that we have created. Most of the things have been done by me. So yes, I have a good experience in tech systems. Yes. Yeah, so we believe that you should not teach something that you have not been doing for a while. So we can only teach things that we have done by ourselves. Cool. Thank you, everybody. We are going to see each other tomorrow. Make sure that you submit the feedback. Sending the form again. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you. Bye. Take care. Thank you. Thank you, Guru. Thank you, Suraj. Thank you, others. Thank you, Manju. Thank you. Thank you, guys. I am going to stop the call for now and we are going to see each other. Cool. Thank you. If you guys need feedback form, let me know now. I've just again posted the feedback form. Please click on it and receive and go ahead and fill your feedback. I'm going to see each other tomorrow. We are going to see each other tomorrow at the same time. Yeah, Shankar, I have no idea about this. We are looking to wrap up this by Sunday. If it is going to take more, I don't think that should be an issue with you because we are managing, it's night time. So I think you guys should be able to take out time. So I'm not going to limit with the kind of things that we are going to cover because maybe a couple of hours here, that doesn't matter in the long term. So we might take more time, but we are going to make sure that we are covering each and every. Thank you, Manvika. Thank you, Shankar. Thank you, Sudeep. Bye. Thank you. Take care. I am stopping the call now. Bye, guys. Bye. Good night. Take care. Thank you.